Well, I want to address something this morning that's a very small thing, but it's bugging me. So I want to call it to your attention so it can bug you too. On Sunday mornings, I get up at 5:25. And so that means usually I'm getting dressed in the dark. Now, sometimes that has meant I've worn two different color socks to church. Sometimes other unusual things have happened. Today, I got here, I was feeling pretty good about things, and made it all the way through the chapel service. And on the way, as I walked over here, I realized that when I pulled my suit out of the closet this morning, Mark, you need to zoom in on me right here. A little moth has had a nice meal of this coat. So I sit here today robed in holiness, if not righteousness. I tell you, you can take a boy out of the country, but oh goodness. Okay, so now you can stare at this the whole service. It's not food. I'm not just a slob. It's not my fault. We've been talking for a couple of weeks. Well, actually, that kind of pertains to what I wanted to say. We sometimes say, you're not getting the big picture. You need to look at the big picture. Sometimes we need to look at the small picture. Sometimes we can find incredible meaning in very small things. And what I loosely call my ministry has largely been spent in looking for God in some of the most trivial and small and unusual places. The writing that I've done, the speaking that I've done has all been centered around that theme, because we say all the time, we believe God is everywhere. So therefore, we should be able to find God in the most insignificant things we can. Did you ever see a picture of a flea that was taken through like an electron microscope, and all of a sudden it's this huge armored alien looking monster, and you realize you had no idea what a flea looked like until you pause to take a very, very close look at it? I kind of feel that way about this one little verse of scripture that we've spent 3 weeks on, Hebrews 12:1. We've looked at it for 3 weeks, and I got to tell you, we're not going to get it all. There's much more than we can cover in 3 Sundays. There's enough in this one verse. If we really devoted ourselves to it, we could find a life in this verse. We could find God in this verse. We could find a reason and a guideline for living. And that's kind of what I've tried to do these 3 weeks, to point out 3 things that we can find in Hebrews 12:1 that will help us run this race that we call life. Let me read the verse for you first, in case you have forgotten it. Hebrews 12:1 says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us." We've been talking about running this race that we call life. I told you the first Sunday, 2 weeks ago, about the cloud of witnesses and how important it was for people to have gone before, how important it was for us to have a community around us, how important it is for you to be part of a Sunday school class or the choir or a small group, or some smaller community that makes you feel a part of the family of God. Don't come in here and just sit for an hour and leave and never speak to anybody, never make any contact. We are your cloud of witnesses. We want to be there for you, and we want you to be there for us. And the second thing we talked about last Sunday was putting aside the weight that encumbers us. And I told you then that the number one weight, I believe, that keeps most of us from running this race effectively is unforgiveness, is not forgiving people who have wronged us in the past. And we carry that grudge, and it gets heavier and heavier and slows us down more and more until we cannot even move. If we can do those 2 things, we're doing very well. But I want to look at the 3rd thing today, which is, what's at the finish line? What is the prize? What is our goal? What are we running towards? All right, now, look at me. How many races do you think I've won? Not very many. I did win a pie-eating contest in college one time. And I nearly won a kind of a race that would have been just perfect and awesome for me. After I got out of college, I was working in McAllen, Texas, and a radio station was having a special promotion that you could enter this contest, and they would draw a name every week, and then they would narrow it down. And I came up to be the runner-up in this contest. Now, here's what the grand prize was. The grand prize winner, you got 2 minutes to go through a record store, and as many albums as you could pick up in 2 minutes were yours. Now, this was like Fort Knox for me, because music was my driving force at the time. And I thought, oh, what I could do in 2 minutes in a record store. And they said, well, you're the runner-up. If the winner can't show up, you get to do the race in his place. But otherwise, here's some Coca-Cola products for you. Well, the night before it was supposed to happen, I went to the record store and I started making my plan. But see, you couldn't get more than one copy of a record. You couldn't just go in and grab stacks at a time. So I went to like the Beatles section and I arranged it so that you could get the entire Beatles catalog with one grasp. Same with the Beach Boys and the same with Chicago. And I worked my way through the record store and I knew exactly where everything was. I could have probably done it in a minute and a half. The next morning, I was there 30 minutes early. The winner was not there. I waited, I paced, I walked. Finally, about 2 minutes before 10 o'clock, here comes this little old man with his children and his grandchildren, and maybe his great-grandchildren. And the kids are all saying, "Come on, Papa, get some records." So they stand him at the front door of the record shop and they say, "Okay, you got 2 minutes, go." And he goes over to the first rack and he starts going, "Oh, I like this one. Oh, I was livid. I couldn't believe it. That should have been mine. I could have been a contender. I could have been somebody." Well, I don't know very much about racing, obviously, especially racing on foot. But I do know a couple of things. And they're worth visiting this morning as we talk about how to run this race we call life. One thing I know about running a race is you got to know where you're going. You got to know where the finish line is. You can't just run and run and run and not have a finish in mind. There's a little clip I was going to show you this morning, but it's very short, and so I decided I would just describe it. It's from a Monty Python show, and they're doing an Olympics of silly events, and one of them is called the 100 Yards for People with No Sense of Direction. And they show 8 people lined up on the track, and they get down in the starting position, and the starter fires a pistol, and these 8 people go off in 8 totally different directions, running as hard as they can. That's so ridiculous until you stop to realize that's how many of us go through life. We are running, running, running as fast as we can, and we have no clue where we are heading. We have no idea where the finish line is, and it's going to come as a big surprise to some of us because we're just running, and we don't even know what we're running for or where we are running toward. You've heard the saying about Christopher Columbus. When he left Spain, he didn't know where he was going. When he got to America, he didn't know where he was. When he got back home, he didn't know where he'd been. But he's a great explorer. Again, many of us go through life like that. We don't know where we're going. We don't know where we've been. But we've done something with our lives. We just aren't really sure what. You have to have a goal. You have to be conscious of what you are working towards to successfully run this race call life. A second thing I know about racing is this: you got to be careful where you look. Rule number one, don't look at your feet. You ever seen a guy win a race running looking at his feet? No, and you won't, because it's the worst thing you can do for several reasons. First of all, you may well run into something if you're not looking where you're going. Second, looking down at your feet, focusing on every step, it's going to throw you off. It's going to make you start to second guess yourself. You're going to start saying, "Oh, that that step wasn't quite right. I hope I can get it better than the second step. Oh, is that step going to, oh, am I taking a long enough stride? Is my pace fast enough? And it can totally incapacitate you by second-guessing every step you make. You know anybody like that who second-guesses every step they make? The mistake we make when we look down at our feet, we lose our focus. We sometimes lose our ability to stay on the track. You remember in the New Testament, the disciples are out in a boat one night on a lake, and they look out and they see a man walking on the surface of the lake. And one of the disciples says, "That's Jesus." And Peter, the hot-headed, impetuous one of the disciples, says, "I'm going to him." And he jumps out of the boat and he starts, wait for it, he starts walking on the water. Just an ordinary guy walking on the water. And then what does he do? He looks down at his feet to say, "How am I doing this?" And when he does, he starts to sink. When we start to focus on each step of the way instead of focusing on the journey itself, we lose sight of the finish line and we veer off our course. Second rule, don't look at your feet, but also don't look back. Satchel Paige, who was a great baseball player of the mid-20th century, used to have 6 rules for staying young, and one of them said, "Don't look back, something may be gaining on you." I like that. Something probably is gaining on you. And looking back is only going to scare you. What are the things that we could look back on that could cause us to veer off our course? Well, the things that are behind us, the past. You may be making a pretty good pace down this race, and you start thinking, "Oh, but what about those things I've done before? Or what about the people behind me?" And we turn and we look, and nothing good can come from it. I remember seeing on a sports video show of a guy in an Olympic race who was running as fast as he could, and he turns to his left to look back and see who's behind him, and a guy passes him on the right, and he never even knew he was there. When we look back, we lose our focus again. We forget the finish line and what we are racing towards. Don't look at your feet. Don't look back. Rule number 3, don't look at the spectators. When you're running a race, you rarely see a racer looking up at the crowd waving. At least you don't ever see one of those guys win. You don't ever see anybody like that do well in the race. Why is that? Well, because, again, we lose focus. But think about this. Those people are spectators. They're not in the race. Maybe if they were able to do what you do, they would be on the track with you. There's a lot of quarterbacks up in the stands that have never been down on the field. There's a lot of people up there that would like to tell you how to run the race. The other thing to consider is sometimes the people in the stands are yelling okay, but they're not yelling for you. They may be yelling for the other guy. Don't let the crowd affect how you run your race, because they don't always have your best interests at heart. As we race through life, we need to be very aware of who we listen to, who we pay attention to, who we take guidance from. All of us have the experience of giving someone advice and then watching them totally disregard it, right? In fact, that's most of our experience. We give them advice, and then they don't even do what we advise them. And we are so wise. Why do they not listen to us? We're perfect, pretty much. But they ignore our advice because everybody has a different story. Everybody has different advice. Everybody has different guidelines and different opinions of what you should do. And when you take your eyes off the race course to pay attention to the spectators, you're liable to stumble. You're liable to fall. So if you can't look at your feet, you can't look behind you, you can't look up in the stands, rule number 4, don't look at the other runners either. Why not? Because you start to compare yourself to them. The race that we are in, this race of life, is an unusual one. Because each of us has to run it in our own way. I am grateful that our God and our faith is not some carbon copy, rubber stamp, one size fits everybody thing. Your salvation, your relationship with God is a thing that you have to work out. And your map and your plan and your journey is not going to look like mine. And the mistake is made when we see somebody else running and we think, they're doing a good job. Maybe I should run just like them. And we try that, and we can't keep up. Or we're running what we think is a really good race, and somebody just comes speeding right by us, barefooted, wearing a three-piece suit. And we go, how did they do that? Well, because their race is different from yours. Your journey is your journey. Don't make the mistake of trying to emulate another person's journey. Don't make the mistake of trying to emulate your pastor or your Sunday school teacher or your mother or your father or the smartest person you ever met. Don't emulate those people. Because I tell you, I sure don't want you emulating me, because I run off the course a lot. I've been out in the barbed wire and the brambles, and I've had my feet full of stickers, and I've lost a shoe out there, and I get off the course all the time, and I'm trying to run a good race, but don't emulate me. Don't look at the other racers. Well, I told you four things not to look at. What are we supposed to look at? Well, I'm going to cheat a little bit. I'm going to read the next verse of Hebrews 12. Hebrews 12:2 says this. Now, the end of verse 1 says, let's run this race that is set before us. Verse 2 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. You want to emulate somebody when you run this race? There is only one suitable candidate. Jesus is the one. This author of Hebrews says, is the one who started the race. He's the one that created the race. And he has run it, and he is waiting at the finish line with arms outstretched, just waiting for you, yelling for you, saying, come on, you can do it. I know you can. And that's who we are to keep our eyes focused on. That's who we want to run like. You want to learn how to love people? Imitate Jesus. You want to learn how to be a good friend? Imitate Jesus. You want to learn how to have healthy relationships with everyone you come in contact with? Imitate Jesus. We get so off track when we imitate other people. Off track. That was a little bit of a pun there, unintentional. But when we imitate somebody other than the one who has run the race perfectly, we veer off the course. We keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, the one who has successfully run this race better than anyone ever before or since. Now, I like it when a teacher or a speaker or a preacher gives me something concrete to do. That's what I have tried to do these 3 weeks, is three things that you can add to your life that will help you have a life that is more joyful, that is more pleasing to God, that will accomplish more, that will infect people with the goodness of Jesus Christ in you. Those three things are not to neglect to have a cloud of witnesses, not to neglect your community. Plug in, be a part, get involved, be there for them. They'll be there for you. The second thing, let go of those weights, those old grudges, those old hatreds, those old hurt feelings that cost you nothing to let go of them, but they will enrich your run immeasurably. And finally, keep your eyes on the prize. What awaits us at the finish line? Who do we get to spend time with if we make it through this race? We get to be with Jesus. And that's worth the travel. That's worth the journey. That is worth the run to claim the prize that waits at the end of this race. I hope that's concrete enough for you. It's the 10th of January. It's not too late to resolve that this year I'm going to do something different. I'm not going to just run in any direction. I'm going to be focused. I'm going to run toward Jesus and away from some of the stuff that's been killing me for years. Would you pray with me? Father, set us free. Break these chains that have bound us for so long. Let us run without growing tired towards you, always with you in our eyes. We ask in Jesus' name.